Now we're going to turn our attention to the end of the novel and look at how Catherine's expectations from the Gothic novel as she visits Northanger Abbey cause her to entirely misunderstand her circumstance and to put herself in entertainingly embarrassing situations, but at the same time cause her to misjudge General Tilney's character, missing his actual quote-unquote villainy for the villainy that she expects of a Gothic villain, and also missing her actual peril for the peril that she believes a Gothic heroine would be subjected to. I don't want to overplay the villainy or the peril, because this is obviously mostly a comedic novel, but I do want to point out that Austen has a somewhat serious point underlying her narrative, which is the importance of understanding the social circumstance so that one does not place oneself in danger of what ultimately for a woman could be a truly disastrous circumstance, making herself unmarriageable in some way. And although Catherine's embarrassment at the end of the novel is temporary and her happiness, we hope, is permanent, she really did expose herself to the possibility of an alternative narrative in which she damaged her reputation enough so that no other suitor would look at her seriously. Fortunately, that doesn't happen. I also want to point out the fact that we're passing over a tremendous number of significant and entertaining passages in the novel. So I hope that even though we're looking at very specific parts, you'll go back and read the whole novel and make sure that you have the opportunity to be entertained by Austen's narrator's somewhat sarcastic but funny irony, and by the delightful characters like Henry and Eleanor and Catherine that she creates. Before we get to the last section of the novel, however, I'd like to call your attention to a passage in the middle of the novel which addresses a specific problem of perception. One of the problems of perception, of course, is the disadvantage for her that she sees the world, or she wants to see the world, in terms of the totally inappropriate framework that she's adopted from Gothic narratives. And that certainly is a limitation. But the other limitation on her perspective is one that separates her to some extent from Isabella and actually makes her more attractive to Henry. And this appears in chapter 16 on page 88. And this is when Henry explains to her one of the benefits of her ways of seeing the world, starting right here. Henry smiled and said, "How very little trouble it can give you to understand the motive of other people's actions." "Why? What do you mean?" "With you, it is not, how is such a one likely to be influenced? What is the inducement most likely to act upon such a person's feeling, age, situations, and probable habits of life considered? But how should I be influenced? What should be my inducement in acting so and so?" "I do not understand you." "Then we are on very unequal terms, for I understand you perfectly well." "Me? Yes, I cannot speak well enough to be unintelligible." "Bravo, an excellent satire on modern language. But pray, tell me what you mean." And by the way, this passage is one that's often quoted, and this is often taken to be a proper satire on people's convoluted use of language. "Shall I indeed? Do you really desire it? But you are not aware of the consequences. It will involve you in a very cruel embarrassment and certainly bring on a disagreement between us." "No, no, it shall not do either. I am not afraid." "Well then, I only meant that your attributing my brother's wish of dancing with Miss Thorpe to good nature alone convinced me of your being superior in good nature yourself to all the rest of the world." Catherine blushed and disclaimed, and the gentleman's predictions were verified. There was something, however, in his words which repaid her for the pain of confusion, and that something occupied her mind so much that she drew back for some time, forgetting to speak or listen, and almost forgetting where she was, till, roused by the voice of Isabella, she looked up and saw her with Captain Tilney preparing to give their hands across. In other words, Isabella is about to go dance with Captain Tilney, despite the fact that she insisted she would not dance at all, her fiancé not being present. In this scene, one of the things that Henry makes clear is that what makes Catherine superior to all the rest of the world is the fact that she is so ingenuous, that she is genuine and doesn't scheme or manipulate, as Isabella, for instance, does, who, in insisting she wouldn't dance with anyone else, readily agrees to dance with Captain Tilney because Isabella is already on the look for a better suitor. And of course, another element that takes place in this scene in relationship to the overall theme of education in the novel is that Catherine begins to note the differences between what Isabella says and how Isabella behaves, which causes her to question, though perhaps not sufficiently, her ability to evaluate character accurately. Isabella shrugged her shoulders and smiled, the only explanation of this extraordinary change which could at the time be given. But as it was not quite enough for Catherine's comprehension, she spoke her astonishment in very plain terms to her partner. I cannot think how it could happen. Isabella was so determined not to dance. These are the first instances of cognitive dissonance, which ultimately, much later in the novel, will result in Catherine recognizing that Isabella is not what she seemed, and that her behavior was not what it appeared. Catherine gets a more marked instance of Isabella's duplicity later on page 95, and this is one of the last scenes before Catherine leaves Bath, so one of her last scenes with Isabella. Catherine, having not seen Isabella for more than a few minutes for several days, sees Isabella at the pump room and finds her sitting in a spot where she can oversee all the arrivals, because Isabella is actually looking for someone, although Isabella claims that it is an out-of-the-way spot, and she likes it because of its retirement. Starting right here, she began first to be sensible of this, that is, not having seen Isabella for a while, and to sigh for her conversation as she walked along the pump room one morning by Mrs. Allen's side, without anything to say or hear, and scarcely had she felt a 5 minutes longing of friendship before the object of it appeared, and inviting her to a secret conference led the way to a seat. "This is my favorite place," said she, as they sat on a bench between the doors, which commanded a tolerable view of everybody entering it either. "It is so out of the way. Of course, Isabella wants it because she can see who's coming in." Catherine, observing that Isabella's eyes were continually bent towards one door or the other, as in eager expectation, and remembering how often she had been falsely accused of being arch, thought the present a fine opportunity for really being so, and therefore gaily said, "Do not be uneasy, Isabella. James will soon be here." Of course, James is not the person for whom Isabella is waiting. "Psha, my dear creature," she replied. "Do not think me such a simpleton as to be always wanting to confine him to my elbow. It would be hideous to be always together. We should be the jest of the place. And so you are going to Northanger. I'm amazingly glad of it. It is one of the finest old places in England, I understand. I shall depend upon a most particular description of it." "You shall certainly have the best in my power to give. But who are you looking for? Are your sisters coming?" "I am not looking for anybody. One's eyes must be somewhere, and you know what a foolish trick I have of fixing mine when my thoughts are 100 miles off. I am amazingly absent. I believe I am the most absent creature in the world. Tilney says it is always the case with minds of a certain stamp." And of course, this betrays that Isabella has been having conversations with Captain Tilney and that they have now gotten past the formal title stage in their relationship. And also betrays that that's who Isabella is actually thinking of at this particular moment. She's waiting for Captain Tilney to make his appearance at the pump room. "But I thought, Isabella, you had something in particular to tell me." "Oh, yes, and so I have. But here is a proof of what I was saying. My poor head, I had quite forgot it. Well, the thing is this. I have just had a letter from John. You can guess the contents." "No, indeed, I cannot." "My sweet love, do not be so abominably affected. What can he write about but yourself? You know he is head over heels in love with you. With me, dear Isabella." And this is, of course, John Thorpe is writing because he believes that he has successfully pushed his suit with Catherine and they will soon be engaged to be married. And so Isabella is suggesting that John is writing because he's in love with her and that he's about to propose marriage. And when Catherine claims that she is unaware of John's love, Isabella, who of course is the one who is so affected in this relationship, accuses Catherine of being affected. "With me, dear Isabella? Nay, my sweetest Catherine, this is being quite absurd. Modesty and all that is very well in its way, but a little common honesty is sometimes quite as becoming. I have no idea of being so overstrained. It is fishing for compliments. His attentions were such as a child must have noticed. And it was but half an hour before he left Bath that you gave him the most positive encouragement. He says so in this letter. Says that he as good as made you an offer and that you received his advances in the kindest way. And now he wants me to urge his suit and say all manner of pretty things to you. So it is in vain to affect ignorance." And of course, the person who is most affected in this relationship is Isabella, not Catherine. But Catherine is the one who's being accused unjustly of being affected. She's simply naive and ignorant. Catherine, with all the earnestness of truth, expressed her astonishment at such a charge, protesting her innocence of every thought of Mr. Thorpe's being in love with her and the consequent impossibility of ever having intended to encourage him. As to any attentions on his side, I do declare upon my honor, I was never sensible of them for a moment, except just his asking me to dance the first day of his coming. And as to making me an offer or anything like it, there must be some unaccountable mistake. I could not have misunderstood a thing of that kind, you know. And of course, we know very well that John Thorpe did propose going to Fullerton to ask for her hand in marriage, and she gave him what appeared to John to be encouragement. But here, Catherine doesn't even remember having seen John that morning. And as I ever wish to be believed, I solemnly protest that no syllable of such a nature ever passed between us. The last half hour before he went away, it must be all and completely a mistake, for I did not see him once that whole morning. But that you certainly did, for you spent the whole morning at Edgar's buildings. It was the day your father's consent came, and I am pretty sure that you and John were alone in the parlor sometime before you left the house. Are you? Well, if you say it, it must be so, I dare say. But for the life of me, I cannot recollect it. So, of course, this is a big moment for John, but Catherine doesn't even recollect it because she was so interested in going elsewhere. The irony of this scene is that Isabella is accusing Catherine of being duplicitous, affected, and arch, when actually it's Isabella who is displacing her own behavior on Catherine. And then Catherine tries to apologize and says, "And you know, we shall still be sisters." "Yes, yes," with a blush. "There are more ways than one of our being sisters." And of course, what that means is if Catherine marries Henry and Isabella marries Captain Tilney, then they'll be sisters in that sense. So in the rest of the scene, Catherine is innocent or ignorant of what John's talking about, what Isabella is proposing to her. And Isabella lets her off the hook because it's exactly what Isabella wants for herself. She wants to be released from her engagement to James, who turns out not to be as wealthy as she thought. On page 92, we get introduced the beginning of the last section of the novel, which is Catherine's visit to Northanger Abbey itself. On page 92, and beginning right here, Catherine learns that Eleanor and Henry will be accompanying the general away from Bath. "I'm very sorry for it," said Catherine dejectedly. "If I had known this before..." "Perhaps," said Miss Tilney in an embarrassed manner, "you would be so good. It would make me very happy if..." The entrance of her father put a stop to the civility, which Catherine was beginning to hope might introduce a desire of their corresponding. Because at the time, one needed to be invited to engage in a long-distance correspondence friendship. Catherine believes this would be Eleanor making the first overtures of a friendship that would extend beyond Bath. But of course, something else is going on. And Eleanor's embarrassed manner is not because she's embarrassed to ask Catherine to correspond, but because she is being forced by the general to invite Catherine to their home. And the general's idea is that Catherine is wealthy, which he has learned from John Thorpe's bragging, because John Thorpe believed he would be marrying Catherine, and has invited Catherine to Northanger Abbey as his first step in getting her engaged to his son and procuring her supposed fortune for Henry. And this is the source of Miss Tilney's embarrassed manner, because it's presumptuous to invite someone who you've barely known for a few weeks to come stay with you at the house, although it turns out that they're both quite happy to have Catherine there later. And we also learn from this, or at least we will in retrospect be able to see, that General Tilney is overbearing and is perfectly happy to impose his will on his children, even to the point where his children become uncomfortable as a result. The entrance of her father put a stop to the civility, which Catherine was beginning to hope might introduce a desire of their corresponding. After addressing her with his usual politeness, he turned to his daughter and said, "Well, Eleanor, may I congratulate you on being successful in your application to your friend," which of course means inviting her to Northanger Abbey, which Eleanor has not yet done. "I was just beginning to make the request, sir, as you came in." "Well, proceed by all means. I know how much your heart is in it. My daughter, Miss Moreland," he continued, without leaving his daughter time to speak, "has been forming a very bold wish. We leave Bath, as she has perhaps told you, on Saturday se'nnight. A letter from my steward tells me that my presence is wanted at home, and disappointed in my hope of seeing the Marquis of Longtown and General Courtney here, some of my very old friends, there is nothing to detain me longer in Bath. And could we carry our selfish point with you, we should leave it without a single regret. Can you, in short, be prevailed to quit this scene of public triumph and oblige your friend Eleanor with your company in Gloucestershire?" I'm almost ashamed to make the request, though its presumption would certainly appear greater to every creature in Bath than yourself. The general is acknowledging how presumptuous it is to invite her to come stay with them on such short acquaintance. Modesty such as yours, but not for the world would I paint it by open praise. If you can be induced to honor us with a visit, you will make us happy beyond expression. 'Tis true we can offer you nothing like the gaieties of this lively place. We can tempt you neither by amusement nor splendor, for our mode of living, as you see, is plain and unpretending. And of course, this is fishing for a compliment, because he is quite proud of his spectacular living arrangements. Yet no endeavor shall be wanting on our side to make Northanger Abbey not wholly disagreeable. Northanger Abbey, these were thrilling words, and wound up Catherine's feelings to the highest point of ecstasy. So this is the invitation of Catherine to come visit the mysterious Abbey. If we skip down to page 94, we see how Catherine's Gothic expectations are thrown into a frenzy by the invitation to an ancient and mysterious abbey. Her passion for ancient edifices was next in degree to her passion for Henry Tilney, and castles and abbeys made usually the charm of those reveries which his image did not fill. To see and explore either the ramparts and the keep of the one, or the cloisters of the other, had been for many weeks a darling wish, though to be more than a visitor of an hour had seemed too nearly impossible for desire. And yet, this was to happen. With all of the chances against her of house, hall, place, park, court, and cottage, Northanger turned up an abbey, and she was to be its inhabitant. Its long, damp passages, its narrow cells and ruined chapel, were to be within her daily reach, and she could not entirely subdue the hope of some traditional legend, some awful memorials of an injured and ill-fated nun. So, of course, she's got this expectation of the abbey being a ruined abbey, which is reasonable. King Henry VIII, during the English Reformation, and later his daughter, Queen Elizabeth, had ordered the monasteries either destroyed or converted to Church of England churches. Any medieval abbey that had been standing full of monks and nuns for previous centuries would have been at least partially destroyed, or converted to a Church of England church, or converted into a home. So Catherine's expectations of being able to visit a home that was once a ruined abbey seems to promise all of her Gothic pleasures. On page 105, Henry and Catherine have been put together in a carriage by General Tilney, obviously to encourage their intimacy. And as they're approaching the abbey, Henry asks Catherine about her expectations about visiting an abbey, completely aware that what she will find is not exactly what she expects. He smiled and said, "You have formed a very favorable idea of the abbey." "To be sure I have. Is it not a fine old place, just like what one reads about?" "Are you prepared to encounter all the horrors that such a building, such as what one reads about, may produce? Have you a stout heart, nerves fit for sliding panels and tapestry?" "Oh, yes. I do not think I should be easily frightened, because there would be so many people in the house, and besides, it has never been uninhabited and left deserted for years, and then the family come back to it unawares without giving any notice, as generally happens." And of course, that's not actually what generally happens except in Gothic fiction. "No, certainly, we shall not have to explore our way into a hall dimly lighted by the expiring embers of a wood fire, nor be obliged to spread our beds on the floor of a room without any windows, doors, or furniture. But you must be aware that when a young lady is, by whatever means, introduced into a dwelling of this kind, she is always lodged apart from the rest of the family. While they snugly repair to their own end of the house, she is formally conducted by Dorothy, the ancient housekeeper, up a different staircase and along many gloomy passages into an apartment never used since some cousin or kin died in it about 20 years before. Can you stand such a ceremony as this? Will not your mind misgive you when you find yourself in this gloomy chamber? Too lofty and extensive for you, with only the feeble rays of a single lamp to take in its size, its walls hung with tapestry exhibiting figures as large as life, and the bed of dark green stuff or purple velvet presenting even a funereal appearance? Will not your heart sink within you?" "Oh, but this will not happen to me, I'm sure." "How fearfully will you examine the furniture of your apartment! And what will you discern? Not tables, toilettes, wardrobes, or drawers, but on one side perhaps the remains of a broken lute, on the other a ponderous chest which no efforts can open, and over the fireplace the portrait of some handsome warrior whose features will so incomprehensibly strike you that you will not be able to withdraw your eyes from it. Dorothy, meanwhile, no less struck by your appearance, gazes on you in great agitation, and drops a few unintelligible hints. To raise your spirits, moreover, she gives you reason to suppose that the part of the abbey you inhabit is undoubtedly haunted, and informs you that you will not have a single domestic within call. With this parting cordial, she curtsies off, as you listen to the sound of her receding footsteps as long as the last echo can reach you. And when, with fainting spirits, you attempt to fasten your door, you discover, with increased alarm, that it has no lock. "Oh, Mr. Tilney, how frightful! This is just like a book, but it cannot really happen to me. I'm sure your housekeeper is not really Dorothy." "Well, what then?" "Nothing further to alarm perhaps may occur the first night. After surmounting your unconquerable horror of the bed, you will retire to rest and get a few hours' unquiet slumber. But on the second, or at farthest the third night after your arrival, you will probably have a violent storm. Peals of thunder so loud as seem to shake the edifice to its foundation will roll round the neighboring mountains, and during the frightful gusts of winds which accompany it, you will probably think you discern, for your lamp is not extinguished, one part of the hanging more violently agitated than the rest. Unable, of course, to repress your curiosity in so favorable a moment for indulging it, you will instantly arise, and throwing your dressing gown around you, proceed to examine this mystery. After a very short search, you will discover a division in the tapestry so artfully constructed as to defy the minutest inspection. And on opening it, a door will immediately appear, which door being only secured by massy bars and a padlock, you will, after a few efforts, succeed in opening, and with your lamp in hand will pass through into a small vaulted room. "No, indeed, I should be much too frightened to do any such thing." "What? Not when Dorothy has given you to understand that there is a secret subterraneous communication between your apartment and the chapel of St. Anthony, scarcely 2 miles off? Could you shrink from so simple an adventure? No, no, you will proceed into the small vaulted room, and through this into several others, without perceiving anything very remarkable in either. In one, perhaps, there might be a dagger, in another a few drops of blood, and in the third the remains of some instrument of torture. But there being nothing in all this out of the common way, and your lamp being nearly exhausted, you will return towards your own apartment. In repassing through the small vaulted room, however, your eyes will be attracted toward a large, old-fashioned cabinet of ebony and gold, which, though narrowly examining the furniture before, you had passed unnoticed. Impelled by an irresistible presentiment, you will eagerly advance to it, unlock its folding doors, and search into every drawer, but for some time without discovering anything of importance, perhaps nothing but a considerable hoard of diamonds. At last, however, by touching a secret spring, an inner compartment will open. A roll of papers appears. You seize it. It contains many sheets of manuscript. You hasten with the precious treasure into your own chamber, but scarcely have you been able to decipher, "Oh, thou, whomsoever thou mayest be, into whose hands these memoirs of the wretched Matilda may fall," when your lamp suddenly expires in the socket, and leaves you in total darkness. "Oh, no, no, do not say so, we'll go on." But Henry was much too amused by the interest he had raised to be able to carry it further. He could no longer command solemnity either of subject or voice, and was obliged to entreat her to use her own fancy in the perusal of Matilda's woes. Catherine, recollecting herself, grew ashamed of her eagerness, and began earnestly to assure him that her attention had been fixed without the smallest apprehension of really meeting with what he related. Miss Tilney, she was sure, would never put into such a chamber as he had described. She was not at all afraid. Now, of course, there's several different things going on here. One, Austen has introduced to her readers who may not be familiar with all the Gothic tropes a quick, brief Gothic narrative. Henry has also primed Catherine for the expectations of a Gothic adventure, which will, in unanticipated ways, play out to Catherine's embarrassment and detriment. But she's also exposed Catherine's naive gullibility. Catherine doesn't really believe the narrative on one level, but on another level she does. On another level she expects to find the abbey exactly the kind of Gothic building that he describes. And when she does encounter later elements of these Gothic tropes in her actual experience, she reacts to them as though they're part of a Gothic novel, not part of the mundane furniture of a modern house that they actually are. noir. Catherine gets caught up in a cycle that she'll reenact many times over the course of the rest of the narrative, building up a huge gothic expectation and trying to judge what's going on based upon that expectation, and then being embarrassed when she discovers just how silly she was. But she has to go through the cycle several times before it really starts to take hold that she's been misjudging the whole time. This pattern really begins innocuously as Catherine is driven up to the Abbey with her expectations of a very gothic Abbey and big, mysterious, mossy, and damp building. And as she passes down the road toward the Abbey, she discovers that it's a very nice gravel-paved driveway, that the Abbey is decorated in a very modern and elegant style, and all of the windows have the gothic arches. They are nevertheless nice, clear, clean windows, not covered with cobwebs and moss and dirt. And so her first exposure to the Abbey is already a disappointment that her gothic expectations are not going to be satisfied. When she's taken to a room, rather than being shoved into a huge, mysterious, and dark chamber, it's a nice, pleasant room where one might sit one's guest, except in the back of the room is a large, high chest, standing back in a deep recess on one side of the fireplace. The sight of it made her start, and forgetting everything else, she stood gazing out on him, motionless wonder, while these thoughts crossed her. This is strange indeed. I did not expect such a sight as this. An immense, heavy chest? What can it hold? Why should it be placed here? Pushed back, too, as if meant to be out of sight. I will look into it, cost me what it may. I will look into it, and directly, too, by daylight. If I stay till evening, my candle may go out. She advanced and examined it closely. It was a cedar, curiously inlaid with some darker wood, and raised about a foot from the ground on a carved stand of the same. The lock was silver, though tarnished from age. At each end were imperfect remains of handles, also of silver, broken perhaps prematurely by some strange violence. And on the center of the lid was a mysterious cipher in the same metal. Catherine bent over it intently, but without being able to distinguish anything with certainty. She could not, in whatever direction she took it, believe the last letter to be a T. And yet that it should be anything else in that house was a circumstance to raise no common degree of astonishment. If not originally theirs, by what strange events could it have fallen into the Tilney family? And so immediately Catherine translates her experience into the Gothic trope, using language that the handles of the chest have been broken prematurely by strange violence, and that the chest has an inscription on it that couldn't necessarily be a T, and therefore must come from some other source. The obvious answer, of course, is that it's an old chest, and silver is a soft metal, and it's heavy, and that the handles have been broken off by someone trying to carry too heavy a chest with two soft metal handles, and that it's an antique. And either it has come into the family as a purchase, or that some member of the family with a different last name married into the family and brought it with them. After all, half of every married couple has a different last name before the marriage. But of course, Catherine, reading through this Gothic narrative, has to translate everything into this exciting and melodramatic context. Her fearful curiosity was every moment growing greater, and seizing with trembling hands on the hasp of the lock, she resolved at all hazards to satisfy her at least as to its contents. With difficulty, for something seems to resist her efforts, she raised the lid a few inches. But at that moment a sudden knocking at the door of the room made her, starting, quit her hold, and the lid closed with alarming violence. This ill-timed intruder was Miss Tilney's maid, sent by her mistress to be of use to Miss Morland. And though Catherine immediately dismissed her, it recalled her the sense of what she ought to be doing, and forced her, in spite of her anxious desire to penetrate this mystery, to proceed in her dressing without further delay. Her progress was not quick, for her thoughts and eyes were still bent on the object so well calculated to interest and alarm. And though she dared not waste a moment upon a second attempt, she could not remain many paces from the chest. At length, however, having slipped one arm into her ground, her toilette seemed no nearly finished that the impatience of her curiosity might safely be indulged. One moment surely might be spared, and so desperate should be the exertion of her strength that unless secured by supernatural means, the lid in one moment should be thrown back. With this spirit, she sprang forward, and her confidence did not deceive her. Her resolute effort threw back the lid and gave to her astonished eyes The view of a white cotton counterpane, properly folded, reposing at one end of the chest in undisputed possession. Okay, so she opens this mysterious chest and finds that it has a bedspread in it. It's in a bedroom, and they've put the extra bedspread in the chest. So clearly, the mystery of this chest has turned out to be rather mundane, and Catherine is, of course, embarrassed to find her expectations so frustrated by reality. She was gazing on it with the first blush of surprise when Miss Tilney, anxious for her friends being ready, entered the room, and to the rising shame of having harbored for some minutes such an absurd expectation, was then added to the shame of being caught in so idle a search, as though she's been caught going through her host's bathroom cabinets. "That is a curious old chest, is not it?" said Miss Tilney, as Catherine hastily closed it and turned away to the glass. "It is impossible to say how many generations it has been here. How it came to be first put in this room I know not, but I have not had it moved, because I thought it might sometimes be of use in holding hats and bonnets. The worst of it is that its weight makes it difficult to open. In that corner, however, is it at least out of the way." So there's a logical explanation for all of the elements to which Catherine had assigned these Gothic mysteries. It's hidden in the back of the room, not because someone was trying to keep it away from notice, because it's out of the way. The lid was hard to open because it's made of very heavy material. And it's in the room because it's a convenient place to store hats and large, unwieldy objects. And of course, Catherine at this moment, embarrassed by her expectations based upon the Gothic narrative, resolves not to get caught in such a trap again. But of course, that resolution is not kept up. One of the things that's also worth noting in this scene that will be repeated in later scenes is that Catherine becomes aware of the absurdity of her expectations when she's exposed to the gaze of another. When she sees herself being seen by someone else, she first then realizes just how silly her expectations are. So in this case, she feels silly when Miss Tilney comes in and sees her investigating the chest. Later, she will feel silly when Henry discovers her investigating his dead mother's room. However, what's really going on here is something different. One of the things we're discovering now is that General Tilney has some very strict expectations about how people around him behave. He's very strict about his dinner time, and he gets very frustrated when people do not show up at the appropriate time. And so Miss Tilney is hurrying Catherine downstairs in order to avoid drawing the general's ire. So while Catherine is so busy looking for a Gothic mystery, what's going on beneath her notice is the actual problem of the general's personality.
Miss Tilney gently hinted her fear of being late, and in half a minute they ran downstairs together in an alarm not wholly unfounded, for General Tilney was pacing the drawing room, his watch in his hand, and having, on the very instant of their entering, pulled the bell with violence, ordered dinner to be on the table directly. Catherine trembled at the emphasis with which he spoke and sat pale and breathless, in a most humble mood, concerned for his children and detesting old chests. And the general, recovering his politeness as he looked at her, spent the rest of his time in scolding his daughter for so foolishly hurrying her fair friend, who was absolutely out of breath from haste, when there was not the least occasion for hurry in the world. But Catherine could not at all get over the double distress of having involved her friend in a lecture, and been a great simpleton herself, till they were happily seated at the dinner table. So General Tilney has fairly rigid habits and an expectation that his children and guests conform to his habits. Another of the general's personality traits that is significant here is his love of ostentation, his nouveau riche desire for displays of elegance and wealth. This is clearly demonstrated by the dining parlor. The dining parlor was a noble room, suitable in its dimensions to a much larger drawing room than the one in common use, and fitted up in a style of luxury and expense which is almost lost on the unpracticed eye of Catherine, who saw a little more than its spaciousness and the number of their attendants. And the general, of course, is quite pleased with Catherine's praise, thinking that he has satisfied her expectations of his wealth and elegance. Of the former, she spoke aloud her admiration, and the general, with a very gracious countenance, acknowledged that it was by no means an ill-sized room, and further confessed that, though as careless on such subjects as most people, he did look upon a tolerably large eating room as one of the necessaries of life. He supposed, however, that she must have been used to much better-sized apartments at Mr. Allen's. No, indeed, was Catherine's honest assurance. Mr. Allen's dining parlor was not more than half as large, and she had never seen so large a room as this in her life. The general's good humor increased. Why, as he had such rooms, he thought it would be simple not to make use of them, but upon his honor he believed there might be more comfort in rooms only half their size. Mr. Allen's house, he was sure, must be exactly the true size for rational happiness. And so clearly he is comparing his displays of wealth and ostentation with other people's as a way of affirming his own importance. Later, in chapter 22, on page 120 and thereabouts, the general will give Catherine a tour of the abbey and the grounds, primarily to show off his wealth and importance through the luxury of his establishment. So the novel is setting up here a tension between two competing stories. On the one hand, we have Catherine's inability to abandon her Gothic framework in interpreting what goes on in the abbey. And then on the other hand, we have General Tilney's actual character, which poses to Catherine the threat of which she's unaware. She's setting up the abbey as a Gothic castle and General Tilney as the villain in a Gothic horror story. But the reality is that this is a real modern house, and the general's villainy has to do with his chasing of wealth and his willingness to sacrifice her to his pursuit of wealth.